Again, welcome. I'm Joan Mooney to our virtual pilgrimage stories. 2 years ago, we had the great privilege of going to Central and Western New York to learn the stories of that whole burnt over region and the social reforms that happened there, including the abolitionist movement, women's suffrage, temperance, all the things that, that historically that area really led the way in. So we are thrilled today to be talking about Harriet Tubman. We're super thrilled to have our guest moderator today, Lindsay Gelman, who is a rising sophomore at North Carolina's Elon University. She's from Annandale, Virginia, and she's gonna take it away and moderate. Thanks, Lindsay.
Thank you, Ms. Mooney. And on behalf of the Faith and Politics Institute, we express our appreciation to you, the participants who are watching today's webinar, and get to learn about the great American who led herself and others to freedom through life and beyond. Today's pilgrimage story is a part of American history that we're all familiar with on a surface level. We know the focus today, Miss Harriet Tubman, is perhaps the most famous conductor on the Underground Railroad. She was called the Moses of her people for liberating hundreds of people from bondage. What we may not know is that she is a decorated U.S. war veteran. She created the first home of retirement for community for all races, and she was a suffragette who never rested and continued to illuminate the path for others towards freedom. Last year, the film Harriet was released to critical acclaim, gathering Oscar, Golden Globe, and Image Award nominations. The movie was based on Harriet Tubman's life story using her biography written by one of our guests, Dr. Kate Clifford Larson, and was informed by Ms. Karen Hill, who is the CEO of the Harriet Tubman Home. And it is my privilege to introduce them and enter right into the retelling of Harriet's life and ultimately our conversation. Ms. Karen B. Hill serves as the president and CEO of the Harriet Tubman Home National Park, which is located in Auburn, New York, where Ms. Tubman housed more than a dozen people as part of the Underground Railroad. The Harriet Tubman Home was established by the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church, which manages and operates the homestead of Ms. Tubman and hosts their annual May pilgrimage. Under the leadership of Ms. Hill, the Harriet Tubman National Historical Park was established on January 10, 2017. Ms. Hill is the leader of the National Women's Suffrage Centennial Commission, which is tasked with developing educational programs to celebrate the 100th anniversary of the U.S. ratifying the 19th Amendment, which we all know granted women the right to vote. Ms. Hill is widely and highly recognized for her dedication to preserving Harriet Tubman's legacy and the history of the Harriet Tubman Home and National Park. And we are delighted that Ms. Hill will share more about this extraordinary servant leader and freedom fighter. Dr. Kate Clifford Larson is the author of 3 critically acclaimed biographies. She is a leading Harriet Tubman scholar and author of Bound for the Promised Land, Harriet Tubman, Portrait of an American Hero. Dr. Larson has worked as an interpretive specialist for numerous public history initiatives relating to Harriet Tubman and the Underground Railroad in Maryland, Delaware, and New York, and is currently a consulting historian. Dr. Larson has appeared on national television and radio programs and is a frequent guest speaker at a professional development workshop for teachers, including the National Endowment of Humanities and Teaching History programs. She has consulted on film scripts, documentaries, museum exhibits, and numerous publications, including the recent feature film, Harriet. Dr. Larson is currently writing a biography of civil rights icon Fannie Lou Hamer, entitled Walk With Me, which is due out in 2021. I myself had the honor of participating in the Faith and Politics Pilgrimage to upstate New York in July of 2018, which was led by Congressman Tom Reed, Congresswoman Carolyn Maloney, and Congressman John Katko. The pilgrimage was inspiring for me, and it's where I met today's speakers. And through learning about Harriet Tubman, I discovered my own passion for civil activism and the historical roots that lie beneath it. So welcome today, Karen Hill and Kate Larson.
Hi, everyone. I'm just going to tell you a little bit about Harriet Tubman's life up and through the Civil War, and then Karen is going to talk about her life in Auburn and her legacy, and we're looking forward to talking to all of you afterwards about it. So Tubman was born on the eastern shore of Maryland in 1822 to enslaved parents. She had four brothers and four sisters. She was the middle child. And she grew up in this environment of a very mixed community of free and enslaved people. And I always like to acknowledge that because in Maryland, world was different in slavery. There were enslaved people and free people, and many families had blended families of free and enslaved. And it's the people in the communities on the Eastern Shore that helped raise Tubman and helped her become the great leader that she became. She has her roots there, and the communities there gave her the sustenance. They nurtured her, they protected her, they educated her. So she took those tools and created an incredible life for herself, and it enabled her to be a great leader. When she was a very small child, she was taken away from her parents and hired out to other white farmers and local people, and about 6 years old. And she described in later interviews how incredibly difficult her childhood was, that she missed her mother desperately and her siblings because she couldn't be with them. She was horribly mistreated and beaten, and she bore the scars from whippings that she received at 6 years old till the day she died in 1913 at the age of 91. But she survived, much to her own determination to survive, but also because of her parents and other people in the community that helped her survive. Three of Tubman's sisters were sold to the Deep South. We don't know what happened to them, but that permanently scarred the family. It was a fact of life in the antebellum period. The tearing apart of families is one of the most horrific parts of slavery. And this is what happened to Tubman. And she remembered those visions of people taking her sisters away till the day she died as well. When she was about 13, she was nearly killed by being hit in the head from an iron weight from a scale on a dry goods store counter. And it took her mother months to help bring her back to some semblance of health. But for the rest of her life, she suffered from epileptic seizures because of that horrific head injury. So I like to remind people of the context of Tubman's life, not only as an enslaved child, young adult, and adult, and the lack of formal education that she had and the lack of resources that she had, but that she also was a disabled person and that she was able to accomplish so much, and she had this disability. And it was no small disability. Her epileptic seizures would happen at any moment. She had no warning, and there was no treatment or medication at the time. It's something that she lived with and accommodated in her life. She was an incredibly faithful and spiritual person. She had deep, deep, profound faith in God, that he was guiding her and taking care of her and leading her on throughout her life. And she often had visions, and that included visual visions and hearing things. And when she would have seizures, she sometimes had hallucinatory activity, but it comforted her because she believed that God and was protecting her, that the universe was protecting her, her ancestors were protecting her. So she grew up with this disability, but she became very powerful and very strong because of her faith. After her head injury, when she was about 13 and she recovered, she was hired out to other families. And in particular, she was sent back to work in an area near where her father lived. She had been separated from him as a very small child. And it was in this place near the water, in a place called Madison, that she grew stronger and more determined. And she became healthier working for the White Stewart family. And importantly, she made connections with Black mariners, watermen, that came in and out of Madison Bay. And it's through many men and women that were part of the waterfront, that were part of the maritime world, that she learned about other places away from Maryland, Dorchester County, and the entire Chesapeake and the Atlantic world and the New England coast. And she learned about where freedom was and where it was safe to go and where it was dangerous to be. And Black mariners had a tremendous communication network throughout the Black Atlantic world, that's what it's called, so that they were sort of the mail system during that time period, connecting Black communities, free and enslaved, throughout the country, and providing information that allowed communities to stay connected and passing information back and forth that was vital to the survival of individuals like Tubman and communities. She eventually became very strong and grew up and met a free man by the name of John Tubman. He was freeborn of free parents, and he they fell in love, and they married at about 1844. And she was allowed to work for herself and pay her enslaver, Edward Brodus, $60 a year, and anything she earned over that she could keep for herself. So this started her entrepreneurship. She saved money and purchased two oxen, which maximized her earning opportunities. And we know that she was hoping that she could purchase her freedom, but her master died before she could do that. And she was being threatened with being sold. So she ran away. She knew that being sold away basically was a death sentence. And she thought she would take the risk and flee. There were local people who helped her. And she found her way all the way to Philadelphia in the fall of 1849. And when she reached freedom, for those of you who have seen the movie Harriet, there's a fabulous scene where Cynthia Erivo is on a mountainside and she's reached Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and the sun comes out. And Tubman said that it was like gold shining all over everything, that she was free and she couldn't believe it. But once she settled in Philadelphia, she realized that freedom had its limitations because everyone she loved was still in Maryland. So she determined that she would go back and rescue her family and friends. And for the next 11 years, she returned about 13 times and rescued about 70 individuals, most of her brothers, their families, friends, and others. That she just could not live without. And she was desperate to rescue her sister Rachel, and unfortunately her sister Rachel, the only one that hadn't been sold away, died before Tubman could rescue her. When she was working on the Underground Railroad, she tapped into some amazing abolitionist networks in the North, and she had an incredible skill of being able to talk to people and inspire them. And a lot of abolitionists talked a good talk, but they didn't necessarily always act. And she demanded that they act, that if they were committed to this cause of freedom, that they needed to act too. And in fact, they did. They were very much inspired by her. And they were amazed by this 5-foot-tall, not formally educated, formerly enslaved person who inspired them to do more and do better and to end slavery and continue the battle, continue the war on slavery. The Civil War, of course, started, and Governor John Andrews of Massachusetts asked her to please go to South Carolina to aid the United States Army in its efforts to end slavery and beat the Confederacy. And she did go to South Carolina, and she became a spy and a scout. She led 8 Black male scouts on their missions to get intelligence for the Union officers, and they were incredibly successful. And she is credited with conducting and leading an armed raid, the first woman to lead an armed raid during war for the United States. And she was heralded in newspapers as the Black She Moses who led this raid. It was pretty remarkable. And Union officers write about her in letters and And they just are amazed at her abilities and how incredibly intelligent she is. She had a military genius about her. And so after the war, she traveled home after stopping in Washington, D.C. to help with the wounded there in hospitals. But she had a household full of loved ones waiting for her to come home. She had purchased a home from William Henry Seward, Lincoln's Secretary of State, in Auburn, New York. And that is where she returned to. And Karen can tell you about Tubman's remarkable continuation of fighting for equality and justice and freedom there in Auburn.
Thanks a lot, Kate. Every time I hear Kate speak, it really does send chills up my spine. And I, Kate's very modest, but up until the time Kate wrote her book, Bound for the Promised Land, most of the nation had only been exposed to books about Tubman that were written primarily for school-age children. So they contained a lot of myths. Until Kate wrote her seminal work, which is well documented, it's when we really begin to understand more fully the rich life of Harriet Tubman. And Kate's book is called, again, Bound for the Promised Land. So for the 70-odd people I see who are watching this, I encourage you to go out and buy the book if you really want to delve into Tubman's life and get a real sense of how incredibly current Tubman is. I've been thinking about that over these last several days, that the work that I do up in Auburn is significant for the purposes of preserving the physical resources of Tubman, but it's even more important, it's of high value because the values of Tubman are so contemporary, they're so relevant to what's going on today. Her seven core values were faith, family, freedom, justice, self-determination, community, and equality. And I can apply those values to so many things that we are grappling with right now. Community, we're all in this pandemic moment where basically we have to wear our masks. Many of us also wear gloves. We have to protect our neighbor. That's community. It's not that we're doing it for ourselves. We're wearing the mask to protect people from us, and others are protecting people as well. And that's community if we all do it together. That's a Tubman value. As we approach this 100th commemoration of women's suffrage, I think of the freedom that was granted women with gaining the right to vote. Now, even though that didn't include Tubman, she knew that that was an emancipation tool. So I see freedom as being very much a part of what we do in 2020. That was a Tubman core value. We're all learning about the importance and significance of family in this pandemic, how we cope with and love our family, both near and far, and do for our family. I mean, I know for my own part, the sense of family has expanded in this COVID moment because we're all trying to do all that we can, while we can, for both neighbor and friend beyond our blood family. And then I think about social justice in this moment of George Floyd. How can you not? I see the murder of George Floyd being, unfortunately, one of the vestiges of slavery. That we still, as a nation, as we still try to conquer social justice as a core value of this nation, Tubman would see the fact that those police persons who were still there standing, some of them standing by, and then the one with his knee on the neck of Mr. Floyd, those are the vestiges of slavery. Those are the vestiges of people who feel, either because of race or because they wear a uniform, that they're better than. So, you know, if Harriet were living today, she certainly would have taken up the cause for seeking justice for Mr. Floyd and his family in that circumstance. But at the same time, she would have been a voice for, let's not tear down those institutions that we also fought for that really serve our community. And we may own some of those institutions. So she would have been a leader, a voice in sort of the strategy for what do we do next. So, you know, I see Tubman as a very relevant figure. And indeed, when we reopen the national park, I expect we will have a lot of visitors who will want to know more about Tubman historically, to know her core values and to link them up to how she is so relevant today. She sustains a lot of people today. I know that people reach out in their emails and they talk about various aspects of her life that inspire them. Women who try to own their own businesses are truly encouraged by Tubman. As Kate referenced, buying the animals that made her more productive and gave her some means of resources in Maryland, to her operating a kiln on her property where she fired the bricks that were used in many of the tremendous mansions in and around Auburn. Those were entrepreneurial skills that were key to Tubman's life. But I think what's really important is, for all the time she spent in Auburn, the whole expanse of that, you saw a great humanitarian. And it's just amazing to me that someone who could have gone through such the heinous system of slavery and seen so much injustice in her lifetime could be this incredible humanitarian. On her property, she established the John Brown Hall, the infirmary, named after her dear friend, John Brown, where she provided very essential medical treatment to everyone in Auburn, Black or white. So we have at the Tubman Park over 72,000 archaeological artifacts, and many of those artifacts come from the ruins of the John Brown Hall. So we could tell you what type of medicine was being dispensed and in what type of vessels. And that takes a tremendous amount of intestinal fortitude to say, I'm going to serve everyone because I see the need. There is a need here. Now, in Auburn, we had a home, and we still have a home for the aged, but at that time, it was segregated. And Tubman felt very strongly that former slaves who were indigent need to be able to be well taken care of as they age in dignity and grace. And I do think, quite frankly, she would have been a real critic of what has happened in this pandemic with respect to how our elderly in nursing homes and in assisted living have been cared for or not cared for, or that proper protocols were not in place prior to this pandemic. I think she would have been an advocate for the fact that a change must come in that regard. But she established on the property a series of 9 cottages, one of which remains today, which give us tremendous insights to the way in which she cared for and nurtured the Negro elderly in Auburn. And she challenged, you know, she was a great believer in God. She was a member of the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church. She pledged her money to the the Thompson Memorial Amy Zion Church in Auburn. But at the same time, she was critical of the efforts. Tubman bequeathed all of her property to the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church 10 years before she passed away on March 10th, 1913. But she was critical of the Reverend Fathers of the church when they wanted to charge a fee for entrance into the home for the aged. And, you know, the home for the aged, the formal title is indigent, which meant she didn't have resources. So Tubman challenged that. Her charity was never ending. It is well documented that she provided fruits and vegetables and other things to sustain and nourish the Auburn community. She provided that to everyone. And I think that you know, when I see people working in food pantries, and that reminds me of Tubman, because that's what Tubman would have done. She would have been the first one to really, you know, have her family create, you know, an assembly line to package the foods that she grew on her property to make sure that everyone had enough to sustain them. She was very keenly aware that food insecurity, not a good thing. She did this knowing that her only thanks would come from God. And that's amazing to do something. And I think that's where we're all challenged, particularly right now. This is why Tubman is so relevant, that we all have to do a good work, whatever that may be, not for notoriety, but because it is the right thing to do. And that's what Tubman did every single day. She had so many obstacles. You know, she, as Kate mentioned, you know, no formal education, but incredible emotional intelligence. I mean, she knew how to command a room. You know, suffragists, because we call them suffragists here in the United States, they were suffragettes in Europe and the UK. Suffragists here, Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton, could not go in certain places and speak of the value of women getting the vote, because as women were getting the vote was being taken away from state by state from Black men. And yet and still Tubman knew as a woman, it was important for women to be brought into that franchise of voting, and that we still had more work to do. So she would go into these lecture halls and do that advocacy. She was one of the few women who could stand up and advocate for women to get the vote, even if it did not include herself. So I don't think it's an accident that Harriet Tubman found her grounding in the Amy Zion Church, which is known as the Freedom Church, because it was a church that linked godly work with earthly good, that you had to be doing the work here for change, to the freedom work. It, you know, so much of what is written about in the Black experience in certain denominations is that you just sacrifice, sacrifice, sacrifice while you're here on earth, because you're going to have such a great, wonderful life in heaven afterwards. But Harriet understood that you had to do the work here of freedom and have a full life here in freedom and teach future generations, I mean, by what you do, of what they should do in that cause for freedom. I mean, this was a woman who worked every day of her life, but not begrudgingly, but for change. And I believe, and this is just my own personal belief, that when Harriet, she never lived in the home for the aged, which stands on the property now, although she did, was cared for a time in one of the cottages. But when she was near the end of her life, I say to myself, she felt more, She felt at rest knowing that the women who were trying to get the vote were preparing for a great, I would say, demonstration, a protest. Back then it was called a parade, but it took place on March 3rd in 1913. And it was from, and it went right in front of the Capitol. It was amazing that we had Alice Paul, who was just really an activist in the suffragist movement, organized this protest, which we called politely then a parade. And she was very glad that that was taking place. And I believe that she knew, because this was exactly 1 week to the day of her passing, that Ida B. Wells, great journalist, African-American journalist, would be participating. And it was the first act of Delta Sigma Theta, the sorority of which I am a proud member. Let me do this, do my little Delta thing. That they would be participating in the parade as well. But she knew that they had the fortitude to say, when the organizers of this protest very much wanted their participation, but wanted their participation at the back of the parade. So that kind of brings me back to where I started with Mr. Floyd, that there are certain things, these well-doing, well-meaning women who very much wanted to have an integrated protest that included African Americans, didn't see their own racism in wanting the African Americans who were participating to participate at the back of the parade. And I feel like that's still what we're seeing in our culture today, and in a most extreme way with the loss of life of Mr. Floyd, that they only see themselves as public servants, but they don't take time and sit with themselves and talk about, to be the best public servant that I can be, I need to examine where my own prejudices are and what I need to let go of in order to let in the light. And that's what, you know, one of the slogan of the Women's Suffrage Centennial Commemoration is forward into the light. And I think that's where we have to take ourselves as a society, is into the light. And that's certainly the way Harriet Tubman lived her life.
Well, thank you, Karen. I think we're going to go to some questions about Harriet, because we want to come back to you two as leaders who have taken up this work in your life and your leadership example. And so I'll go to Lindsay first to see if something's burning on her mind.
Actually, I do have a question for Kate. So your biography of Tubman's life, Bound for the Promised Land, I think is a masterful portrayal of Tubman's life, and you can tell on the film, which is awesome. But, you know, we all grew up learning about Harriet Tubman through, you know, the children's biographies and stories of the Underground Railroad. But before your research, like Karen said, there were only a few adult biographies of her, and it was with limited content. So I think my question for you is, like, why did nobody write about Miss Tubman in depth before, and how did you come about writing about this incredible woman who, you know, we knew so little about, but, like, is so deeply seared in our memories as American hero?
So I think thank you, Lindsay, for that question. I think one of the reasons that no one had researched her life or written about her is because I think a lot of people thought, well, we know her. You know, there's the books from the 19th century. There are all the children's books. What's more to know? But fortunately, in the 1960s and 70s and 1980s, African-American studies, women's studies became more established, and people were looking at our history through a different lens and thinking about, do we know enough? What really happened? And I was influenced by that. So when I went to graduate school in the 1990s, Tubman captivated me, and it started because my daughter was in second grade and she came home with a little children's book of Harriet Tubman. And I thought, gee, I need to know more about this woman. And when I discovered there wasn't much out there, that sent me on what is now a 25-year journey of researching her life. And so she's just captivated me. And her story of her resilience and her, it's made me look at the world so differently and to look at people differently. And here was a woman that had really nothing and came out of the most obscure, horrific circumstances. And she rose up. She was born a genius. And it was this community around her that nurtured that and enabled her to blossom. And I think this is something we all need to be aware of today. There are women and men in our communities today who have those abilities, and we need to nurture them and support them so that they can rise up and be leaders. We need to recognize them in our own communities. And so that's what, you know, Tubman became that person, and people recognized that about her when she reached, you know, the North, and even in her own community in the South, people knew there was something special about her. And that specialness lasted till the day she died, and her legacy lingered up until now because there was something really incredible about her. And for some of us, we still want to find out more about her, because I think we owe it to her and we owe it to ourselves and our democracy to uncover what leadership is. And Karen was beautiful in the way she talked about Tubman as this servant leader. And we should emulate those values, those core values that Karen talked about more.
Thank you. And we're going to go to lightning round with questions, because we have quite a few that on the board. And I know Lindsay has some too. But Devin in Kent, Washington, who's a student at the Institute for Community Leadership, he says, we talk about struggles that we have in our country while talking about poverty and racism and how we can overcome them. Knowing what life was like for Harriet Tubman, you know, a person who wasn't a lesser person would have given up. So besides faith, what was her motivation that caused her to persevere and become that amazing leader that we all know?
Well, I'll take this one. I don't want to minimize faith, okay, of the seven core values. And Kate and I and other leaders, we spent hours and hours and hours in a room sort of going through this process. Her faith was so strong. That's really was the primary motivating value, quite frankly, faith. And whether it's within one of the organized religions or something that you would deify in terms of being a principle that you want to use as a guidepost for how you're going to walk in this life is what's most important. And she was so consistent. Now for her, faith and freedom came together. And I think that's how she came to the African Methodist Zion Church. You know, because she has such a strong faith walk, she needed to have her freedom married to her faith. And I think right now our country is really hungry just to have a stronger belief. You know, many of us talk about, you know, wanting to know more about our Constitution because we value our democracy in a way now that I think, quite frankly, some people may have taken for granted, but now we know our freedoms are so important and they're so tenuous. You know, I think we know how tenuous they are now. I was doing another talk when I spoke of our desire, and Joan, I'm gonna challenge you on this because this is something we'll be doing in 2021, 2020. Who is having a service in Washington, D.C. at one of the great houses of worship, where we want to lift up Harriet Tubman and her servant leadership. Because one of the great frustrations in our society, and I don't mean just Washington, I mean everywhere in our communities, in our cities, in our states, is that we have so many leaders and so few servants. Mm-hmm. And we need more servant leadership. I think that was very fundamental to Tubman, is that yes, you can be a leader, but you've got to also be a servant. It's like walk the walk, you know, just don't talk it, you've got to do it. I mean, the fact that she, you know, created those cottages for the elderly, the fact that she created a place where people could get health care. You know, when we were having the fight about affordable health care, as we still have going on right now, I think of how Tubman did such a bold move and said, here's what I can do. People need to have access to health care. You know, we need to take care of our elderly. We need to grow fruits and vegetables so people know what fresh produce is and what they're putting in their bodies. We shouldn't have food insecurity. In fact, her home on our property was used as a place for battered women long before it became culturally okay to speak publicly about women being battered, because it was like a dirty, dark secret. Tubman took in women who were not being well treated at home, them and their children. And she just knew her service to her community was important. And I think we have to figure that out for ourselves individually, where we fit in. And when we find where we fit in, we need to go to work. Whether it's changing something, or it's just immediately being able to put on an apron or whatever it is and getting our hands dirty and getting in there and making a difference. We cannot sit on the sideline. That is not acceptable. It's what's on the inside is what comes out. And it starts with your belief system.
Yeah.
The thing that I like to tell people is that she believed in the promise of America. And I think that's where we kind of get stuck, because we see a lot of what's around us right now. We may not like it, and we can't see beyond that. Harriet was able to look over the horizon and see the promise of America, that it was going to be so much better than what it had been, and she was willing to do the work to make it better.
Karen Hill and Kate Larson, on behalf of all participants today, we'd like to thank you for sharing the inspiring story of Harriet Tubman with all of us. Now that we're all aware of how much is left out of our history books, you've really raised our interest in learning more about this amazing freedom fighter and leader.